Thank you very much for the introduction, and I want to thank the Vlis for the kind invitation. It's a pleasure and also an honor being here and being able to present some novel work. It hasn't been published yet in full. A novel work entitled Alpha Nematides, a novel family of marine peptide neurotoxins from ribbon worms. And this has been the fruit of an extensive collaboration with several labs in Uppsala in Sweden, where then the worms are coming from the North Sea in Sweden. Also a collaboration with the University of Queensland, Brisbane in Australia, where also Professor Vetter is coming from, and then with my lab. As an introduction, what are Nemertea? What has this to do with marine life? Well, Nemertea are a phylum of invertebrate animals. Most of them are marine organisms, but they also can live in a terrestrial environment. We know them more popular as ribbon worms, and they have the special feature of having a proboscis, so you can say they have a proboscis worms, and this is a kind of an elongated appendage from the head that they use for feeding behavior, for defense. Interesting is the fact that they are considered as carnivores, so they feed in the marine environment on annelids, on clams, on crustaceans. And also they have to defend against these creatures. Being a toxinologist, so a toxicologist interested in toxins, this is an important element. When you discover peptides in these animals, they can always be, let's say, used for defensive but also offensive purpose. Now the appearance of these ribbon worms is quite fascinating, at least for me as a non-biologist. They are very diverse in size. They can range from 20 centimeters only up to 55 meters. And as such, it has been claimed that they are really the longest animal on Earth. Whether that's true or an alternative fact, I don't know. So 55 meters. We know of the existence already for many hundred years from now. So in 1555, there was a scientist, Olaus Magnus, who described for the first time a 17 meter long marine worm. And he described that the width of a child's arm whose touch made a hand swell. So you can compare it here, indicating already a very fascinating pharmacology behind. Then in 1758, another scientist, William Borlase, described the sea long worm that he discovered. But we had to wait till 1806, where then James Sowerby described what we still know scientifically as Latin name, Linnaeus longissimus, and here the reflection to the longest animal on Earth is a reflection thereof, Linnaeus longissimus, also known as the bootlace worm or the longest animal on Earth. And it's this animal that has been collected in the North Sea in Sweden, where we did some study and found interesting novel peptides. So that's the introduction. From an anatomy and morphology point of view, when you see this Linnaeus longissimus, you can depict the animal as having a brain, a mouth, from which an extended proboscis can be developed, occur. And then it's kind of a hollow structure where, besides the excretory organs, you have a longitudinal nerve cord, you have checa, ovarius, and then an anus. And of course, everything that is being fed by Linnaeus enters then this, let's say, cavity, is being degraded, serves as food, and then disappears via the anus. From these animals, when they were, let's say, put in a marine container, so a container with marine water, the mucus from the epidermis, so the mucus from the epidermis was collected as a starting material, and the classical biochemical and analytical techniques were deployed, chromatography, size exclusion, reversed phase, and from this, initially, we discovered three main peaks representing the peptides that we described later on. Beta 1, Alpha 2 and Alpha 1, and I will only dwell today on the Alpha family. After the classical purification, we have then, in collaboration, done MSMS sequencing, apart from the classical Edman degradation sequencing. So these peptides were reduced, alkylated, subjected to chemical cleavage, as you know, from which a series of typical fragments appear, and via MSMS technology, you can do then the sequencing, revealing the primary structure of the peptide, which I will show in the next slide. But moreover, since these Nemertea and the presence of these bioactive peptides was so far very scarcely studied, we have also employed a very, I think, for me, fascinating technique, which is called imaging mass spectrometry. And with imaging mass spectrometry, and this is a MALDI-TOF-TOF system, you can really visualize where the peptide or protein or structure of interest is located in the animal. So what you do, or what you see here, is a cross-section of such a worm, fixed in fact, or frozen. And then, once you know the primary structure of the protein or peptide you want to study, you give it in fact, in the software, and you let the machine, the MALDI instrument and the TOF-TOF spectrometer, search where it will recognize the most abundant place, let's say, of this peptide. And as you can see, for the beta, but also the alpha 2 and 1 peptides, they were very interestingly located, let's say, sub-epidermally, but not, let's say, in the middle of the worm. So this, again, is a cross-section. What is then the sequence? Well, the sequence was revealed, as I said, via the classical biochemical methods, but also via a transcriptomical analysis. And the nemertide alpha 1 and alpha 2 revealed a primary structure of 31 amino acids, where alpha 1 and alpha 2 can be considered as a kind of isoforms, because there is only one amino acid difference, is phenylalanine and valine. Everything else was comparable or similar. So the primary structure was revealed, as I said, thanks to also cleavage with chymotrypsin and trypsin. All the individual fragments were checked. And interestingly, the C-terminus didn't contain the usual proline, but hydroxyproline residues. And this is kind of an example, which we all know, of post-translational modification. So hydroxyproline, hydroxyproline, and Q. In the middle is shown the result from the transcriptomics. So also an animal was sacrificed to do the transcriptomic type of analysis. High-throughput Illumina sequencing was deployed, and then you, of course, can do conceptual translation into predicted proteins or structures derived from the RNA information. And from this, the mature toxin was revealed. The mature toxin, where also C-terminal lysine was discovered, that in reality, let's say, as a toxin was cleaved off. So this is also, again, an example of post-translational modification. But the interesting approach from the transcriptomic approach or technology is that you can also have more information on the pro region, which is then preceding the mature region or toxin, and also the ER, endoplasmic reticulum signal, which then is in fact a signal to highlight the processing. Should this protein, when it's, or toxin when it's matured, stay in the cytosol, in the mitochondria? Should it be, go elsewhere? That is what we believe is a function of an ER signal. And the pro-region is a kind of a prodrug, you can say. That is then when maturation is completed, here cleaved off. So with all this knowledge, we came to the primary structure of alpha 1 and alpha 2. Again, only one residue difference. And interestingly, these are small proteins, so peptides, as we say, characterized by a high content of cysteines, so 6 cysteines giving rise to 3 disulfide linkages. So they are heavily reticulated, which is no surprise for toxins, because in a certain way it makes these molecules very resistant to proteases. Then the NMR structure was verified based on a synthetic analog. The synthetic molecule was also co-eluted in classical chromatography to make sure that it was having the same retention time as the native material. And from several energy minimized structures that you see here on the left, you can depict, let's say, a structure that is what we call reminiscent of a so-called ICK, I'll show it in the next slide, an inhibitor cysteine knot motif. What does it mean? It's a scaffold that Mother Nature uses in marine and terrestrial organisms when they produce peptides or toxins, a very so commonly used scaffold, where in this case you see three disulfide bridges, and one of those three is really making a knot, giving a very rigid structure in terms of shelf life or half life. Here below left you see the hydroxyproteins in the C terminus, and then if you rotate it 180 degrees, you see here again the phenylalanine at position 8, which is different between alpha 1 and alpha 2 memetide. As I said, they belong to the inhibitor cysteine knot scaffold and motif. In literature, you will see ample evidence of such peptides. So we also were interested to compare this alpha 1 from the bootlace worm with other already described peptides in the literature and databases. Interestingly, there was some analogy with LEAP2, even when this LEAP2 peptide has only two disulfide bridges. But what is this LEAP2? It's an antimicrobial peptide that you and me make in the liver. So it's really in our human genome. This is an, of course, vertebrate animal peptide with known antimicrobial activity deriving from the liver. But coming back to animal kingdom, also spiders, acetoxin here, and then escitoxin, they are examples of respectively a tarantula toxin, and then a funnel web spider toxin. There are clearly homologies between our newly discovered alpha-1 peptide from nematode. What do they do? So LEAP2 is known to be antimicrobial, but then the spider toxins, they respectively block voltage-gated calcium channels and voltage-gated potassium channels. So this also indicated, maybe these nematea have peptides that also target ion channels. And indeed, this is then a summary of the bioassay techniques we have employed. In panel A, left above, we have used a kind of a crab lethality assay, so the green literal crab. The peptide was injected, so alpha-1 was injected at the concentrations you see here, microgram per kilogram, between leg 1 and 2 of the cephalothorax of the crab. And as you can see, from 1 microgram per kilogram, paralysis was observed and death occurred in the range of 10 to 50 micrograms per kilogram. This was already an indication that the peptides are very bioactive, but what was the target? And I'm very happy that Professor Vetter already introduced you this morning voltage-gated sodium channels, because indeed the traces you see here below are also examples of electrophysiology traces of voltage-gated sodium channels expressed in a heterologous system. What does it mean? Probably you remember from Professor Vetter's talk that you have isoforms NAF11, 15, 18, etc. So also in my lab we have cloned these, and we can put this DNA into a kind of a host cell, which is an oocyte from Xenopus levis. It produces then the target, the receptor, and via voltage clamp electrophysiology you can measure the current coming from an overexpression of the clone you want to express. Why is this system robust and useful? Because here in panel B, these three traces are also sodium channels, but not from us, not from you and me, but from invertebrates. This is from the cockroach, Vlatella germanica. In the middle is a sodium channel clone from the Drosophila, from the fruit fly. And here, Varroa destructor, is a sodium channel from the mite, an arachnidae. Remember, these nematea, they feed and have to defend on also sometimes invertebrates, sometimes crustacea, so not always higher order organisms of vertebrates or mammalian. And what we saw is that little nanomolars of the toxin alpha-1 modified the sodium channels from, for instance, the cockroach and Drosophila and the mite incredibly. So in control, what you have to see is you have a very transient influx of sodium that then inactivates just enough to generate action potentials, as you have seen in the talk of Professor Vetter. That's the normal physiological situation. you apply, in this case, only 6 nanomolars, 6 nanomolars of the toxin, and what you see is a tremendous increase of the current that does not inactivate anymore. And this is, for us, very a good indication that you create cytotoxicity because of sodium overload. And very well-known molecules like DDT as an insecticide do exactly the same as this, but much less potent. This is much, much more efficient and more potent. So the effect is very, very impressive in invertebrate sodium channels. As a comparison, then, of course, we compared our human or vertebrate sodium channels. And here, indeed, there is some modification in the same trend. However, all the concentrations you see in panel A, i.e., for the vertebrate sodium channels, are assayed with 1,000 times higher concentrations. So you talk about here micromolars. And then, of course, you see for some channels a modification. Here it's lower nanomolars, indicating that you can talk about a certain insect selectivity. On the right, and I also will not dwell on that too much, again, Professor Vetter introduced this. This is for us as electrophysiologists, so-called steady-state activation and steady-state inactivation curves. And because this toxin or peptide is modifying these sodium currents in invertebrates so dramatically, I only will emphasize this one slide, the steady-state inactivation in control. So it means, what is the percentage to find the sodium channel inactivated as a function of voltage? So this is in control. Well, what the toxin is doing is really, let's say, avoiding this inactivating state, and for the whole voltage range, this channel will remain active. Of course, if you are, let's say, the prey, and you get injected such a peptide, it's lethal, that is very clear. So that's why we also do this kind of offline analysis. So what is the summary? We believe that indeed North Sea ribbon worms, in particular this Linnaeus longissimus, is a very, very valuable tool to study and still to study in the future. I've shown you evidence of alpha nemertides, which really is another family of peptide neurotoxins from the mucus. They adopt this inhibitor system, not scaffold. Thanks to the transcriptomal analysis, we have found alpha nemertides, 8 in total, very homologous in structure, sometimes only with one amino acid difference, so they are kind of natural mutants. And we have then studied more in depth the alpha 1, which is found to be the most abundant in the mucus. It was synthesized, and it was shown that it very potently paralyzes the littoral crab, Carcinus maenas, at 1 microgram per kilogram. It can inhibit not only the cockroach, Platella germanica sodium channel inactivation at low nanomolar concentrations, but also the fruit fly, the mite. And as such, we believe that these peptides can be candidates for the development of insecticides. A worm never meets an insect because it's living in the sea. In terms of evolution, what is then the explanation? Well, we believe, think about crustacea. They prey on crustacea, they have to defend against crustacea, and in evolution and phylogeny, crustacea are very close to the hexapoda, the insects. So this could be an explanation why also these worms are equipped with wonderful insecticides that hopefully we can still develop in the future. And with this, I will end, and if there are any questions, I will be happy to take. Thank you.